Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome back to Elm Street Christian Church online. So I just want to say it's been fun hearing different people from all over the country, again, even around the world, that they're watching what we do. So let's continue, all of us, knowing that people are watching us Christians. Let's continue living out our faith, plugging away. And so I just wanted to open up with a word of prayer, and then we'll jump into worship this morning. So let's pray. God, we are grateful for what you've done for us. God, help us to never forget your Son, his humility, his patience, even him considering where we are as lost people, willing to die for us, willing to rescue us. And so, God, I pray that we will have that same attitude towards others. And so, God, we come before you now to give you the glory, honor, power that you deserve. Help us to press into this time to truly seek you, hear from you. And, God, I pray that we will leave this service changed, ready to do more of your work here on earth. For it's living as Christ and dying as gain. In your son's name I pray. Amen. Let's worship.
You are holy. You are mighty. You are worthy. Worthy of praise. I will follow, I will live the same, I will love you all of my days. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
So, good news, bad news. Good news is I have a lot of honey. Bad news is my bees left. I don't know where they went. It's too cold to go anywhere, but my bees left their hive. I have two supers. So a super is a deeper box with frames in it. So I've got two of those, and then I've got a medium on top of that. They left it full of honey, and they left so much honey. It was more than 5 gallons of honey. 5 gallons. So I spent this last week harvesting that honey, taking off the caps. I got an extractor where it spins them around, throws the honey, goes down into a tub, and then you gotta clean it and all that. So anyway, I've been filling all that up, but I just can't get it out of my head. Why would bees leave 5 gallons of honey? Do they not even know what they're missing, right? Had a nice setup. I take care of them. I leave them alone. I make sure that there's no insect problems, no mites. You know, I got a garden for them to get all the pollen they need. But they left. And I think, do they even know what they left, right? Dumb bees, that's what I think. But as I get into Philippians chapter 2, Paul kind of has this idea of, do you even know what you're missing, right? So Philippians chapter 2, we're going to read the first couple verses. So he says in Philippians 2, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, right? If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, any, even a little bit, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete. So as you go through these, you know, here we have clauses. And in fact, in Greek, there are no verbs here. It just says, if you have this. So by whatever appeal you may have in relationship with Christ, if any encouragement here. Is that, so I'd encourage you right now, think back. In your church world life, right? Your connection with other believers, have you had any encouragement? Right? Has anybody built you up or helped you in your faith? Have you had any comfort from God's love? And this word comfort, it has this idea of someone coming alongside of you, putting their arm around you in a friendship way, and giving you good words. So has anybody done that for you? I like what Ravi Zacharias said, because some of us feel far from God, right? And maybe thinking, okay, I'm thinking back, I've really not had encouragement, or really have not felt this love. Ravi said, the reason we sometimes have the false sense that God is so far away is because that's exactly where we put him. We've kept him at a distance, and then when we're actually in need and call on him in prayer, we wonder where he is. He's exactly where we left him. So here in these first four verses, there's this, if you have any, right, any encouragement, any comfort, I wonder if some of us have driven God away to keep him at arm's length, right? Like we like some of the things that God does, but we don't want him completely in our lives. Let's not forget that God is love, that the church exists to carry that on in love. And so he goes on. I'm going to keep going. This idea of, still in verse 1, if any fellowship with the Spirit. And that fellowship, again, we talked about earlier, is this koinonia, this mutual harmony. Do you have any mutual harmony, any type of kindred spirit with your church, with the Spirit? If you've been brought into the fellowship with God's people by the Holy Spirit, then live accordingly. If you have any tenderness and compassion, I like this word, it's literally bowels and mercies. And of course, back then, people would say, I love you with all of my bowels, all my intestines, I love you. Where we say, I love you with all of my heart, right? So they would, their seat of emotion sat here. If you have any emotional attachment, any type of mercy that you have felt from God and his people, if you know anything of the mercy and compassion shown to you by God in Christ, as you most certainly do, then please respond yes to my request. That's what Paul's trying to say here. If you have any type of positive feelings, right, any type of history at all that has encouraged you in your walk with Christ, Paul says, then make my joy complete. Say yes by making my joy complete. And so I started thinking, here Paul's trying to build up this idea of if you have any respect, right, for God, for the church, that moves you to action. If you have any care, right, that care causes, should cause a response from me. If someone cares for me, I'm going to respond to that. Love motivates to deeds. If someone respects me, cares for me, loves me, then that moves me to action. It causes a response within me, and it motivates me to deeds. Has God, has the church done that for you, drawn you towards action, caused you to respond like a life response to God? Has it caused you to want to do good deeds? And here I picture in verse 2, Paul says, I want, if you have any of those good mojo feelings, right, then make my joy complete. I can't help but think sometimes with the soccer and coaching, I ask the kids, well, why do you play soccer? And they give me all kinds of reasons. I say, no, 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 no. The reason you play soccer is to make me happy. I almost wonder, as I first read this, is Paul saying all this? Like, make me happy. Make my joy complete, Philippians. Right? If you've felt any good feelings, then continue out by saying yes and make my joy complete. And I'm like, wow, is Paul being selfish here? Is this all about Paul? But no, this is all about a byproduct. This joy is a byproduct of knowing that the Philippians are going to live hand in hand, right, unified in humility. In fact, I'm going to say this phrase a lot. Unity, hand in hand with humility. So the joy, that Paul is saying. That's not his end game. The end game is this unity hand in hand with humility. And so he goes on and he says, by being like-minded, make my joy complete by being like-minded. And this like-minded, again, it's not just thinking the same. It's not just mental, but it's emotions, it's attitudes, it's will. Cranfield says, there are powerful tensions that are held together by an overmastering loyalty to each other's as brothers and sisters in Christ. Such unity will only come when Christians are humble and bold enough to lay hold on the unity already given in Christ and to take it more seriously than their self-importance. So this humility, this unity is going to have to be killed, or it's going to have to, the only way it's going to live is if we can kill our idea of self-importance. So being like-minded, not just mental, emotions, it's our attitudes, it's our will coming together. Paul is asking for us to be unified, hand in hand, locked together with humility. And I started thinking, boy, Jason, that sounds great. That we all come in here, right, wherever we are even now, that we're going to be unified, hand in hand, holding hands with humility. That's easy to say unless you're mad at somebody. Right? It's easy to say, yeah, I want to be unified with my brothers and sisters until they tick me off. It's easy to say, yeah, we're going to be unified, hand in hand with humility until somebody hurts somebody else in my family. Because now all of a sudden, I don't feel so unified. My self-importance and protecting people who are really close to me is now damaging that unity. So I just started thinking, here we are. It's easy to say you should live Christian. But when you actually put this into practice, it is hard work. And we're going to talk about how that can actually happen. And I'm going to tell you right off the bat, you can't do that on your own. You need Christ to be able to work in you, to develop you, to build you up, to be able to accomplish this. It is not a mind over spirit thing here. You need Christ to do this. So it's easy to do. It's easy to say unless you're mad, hurt, confused. Really, hand in hand, I'm going to go hand in hand with somebody who hurt me. And so he goes on and he says, I want you to be one in spirit, to share the same affection, desire, passion. I want you to be one in purpose. Have in mind this one thing, that we're going to be unified hand in hand with humility. Paul repeats this same idea four different times. Unity, hand in hand with humility. Why? Why is this the pinnacle of it all? Well, it's essential for the spiritual growth of the church. For us to grow, for us to move to the next level, we have to be unified. We're going to have to do this hand in hand and be humble toward one another. It's essential for spiritual growth of the church. It's essential for the progress of the gospel. It's essential for victory. So verse 3, he says, do nothing. So how does this practically work out? Verse 3, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. I've been coaching a long time, and I've been able to coach really good players. And I've also had the privilege of coaching really good teams. I love coaching good teams better than good players. Because sometimes you get that good player, and that good player plays for himself. Right? It's all about him, what he wants, his style, what he's going to do. And we've had, as we've coached, we've had bad players, but they're on great teams. Teams that are unified, they share the ball, they have in mind the same purpose, the same goal, they're one in spirit, and they are unified hand in hand with humility, realizing nobody here is better than anybody else, and they beat other teams they shouldn't beat because they have that unification. Church, this is what Jesus is calling us to do, right? It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about the one purpose, advancing the gospel, helping others know Christ, right? To make him known, for us to get to know him deeper and better. It never ends. So nothing from selfish ambition. Unity can't exist with individualism. Unity can't exist with individualism. And you can't be unified when you practice your faith alone. And I know there's people probably right now watching in this online service, you practice your faith by yourself. To Jesus, that doesn't make any sense. It's got to be unified, hand in hand, practicing humility with other people. Nothing from conceit, empty opinion, right? And so this word here from conceit, it's almost like people like to fight to prove that they're right. Where there is empty conceit, there is no unity. And to make this practical, stop telling people what you think. Right? We love sharing our advice and opinion. I think even more now so in our culture with Facebook and Twitter, everybody likes to throw everything that they're thinking out there, right? As though they've got it all figured out. Stop telling people what you think, and I'm going to ask you, even with Scripture here, start asking people what they think, especially in relation to church believers, right? We like to think that our opinion is it's like gold, right? We just got to keep throwing it out so everybody knows everything that we think because we got it figured out. I'm going to ask you, flip it on this upside down. Start being the person that asks other people what they think. And if you look through here, it rings through this a little bit. Each of you should not look only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. And in verse 3, in humility, consider others better than yourself. If they're better, you probably want to know what they're thinking. Right? If you're going to look to the interests of others, you're going to need to know what they think. And so we've gotten into this culture where we think our opinion, we just got to throw it out. Now I'm going to just keep telling everybody what I think. Flip it a little bit. Try and start asking people, what do you think about this? What are your thoughts? Stop telling people what you think and start asking what they think. And part of that is some of us has taken on that idea of I'm always right, and you may be right. But if you come at this with you're so right, you're going to drive people away to where they don't care what you think. They don't care for your opinions. Don't drive people away by doing this empty conceit. And so in humility, consider, right? End of verse 3, in humility, consider others better than yourself. This word consider, in humility, consider, it's this word consider is carefully calculate, right? I'm going to weigh the options here. Carefully consider others better than yourself. This has got to be hard, right? Even thinking of all the people in Olney. Or even let's localize it. Everybody in church is better than you. Everybody in church is better than me. I consider them higher than myself. That's hard to do, right? Because people have made me mad. People have gotten me agitated or frustrated. They're higher than myself. And to have this thought, we are here because we exist for others. I will consider others better without restriction. Unity begins when we discover respect, care, and love for each other without grounds. Right? Our normal concept is, I will respect you if you follow this. I'm going to love you if you do this. So without reason, the only reason would be that unity, hand in hand, with humility. It coerces me to action. It causes a response within me. It motivates me to go beyond what I could do on my own. So here we are at the crux of the matter. The whole central part of what Paul is saying here. If there's any encouragement, right? If there's any comfort, if there's any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness, any bowels and mercies, right? Tenderness and compassion, be humble. This is the crux of the matter, the linchpin that ensures the success of Christian community. And this word isn't found in any other part in the Greek language until now. This is amazing. Like, it's almost like this is a new concept Paul is bringing into the Greek language. Now, the adjective conveyed being base, right? Or unfit, shabby, of no account. You can find it in Hebrew throughout the Old Testament. Listen to this. So God chooses the unimportant and small for his plans. 1 Kings 18:23, Psalm 118:67. He's constantly looking for humble, humility, right? God saves the lowly and the humble. Psalm 17:28. God looks upon the lowly. Psalm 112, verses 4 through 6. God pays attention to the prayer of the lowly, right? The humble. Psalm 108, verse 18. God gives grace to the lowly while he opposes the scoffers. Isaiah 2:11, Ezekiel 17:24. Humility is the crux. It's the linchpin. It's the pinnacle of how all this is supposed to come together. So if you have any encouragement, if you have any comfort, any fellowship, any tenderness and compassion, make my joy complete by being unified hand in hand with humility. Verse 4, it goes on. Each of you should not look only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Fix your eyes. Like, look to the interests of others. Fix your eyes. Notice. Look out for. Keep your eyes on. So right now, your main purpose, what you're doing while you're not here, exercising your ministry out in Richland County, to the state, to the ends of the world, you are to look out for, to search for people. Right? Search for people to help out their interests, to look out for them, to fix your eyes, to notice them, to keep your eyes on. So if there is a needy person, you're the first responder, because that's what you're looking for. You're considering them better than yourself. Don't just look for your own interests, which, man, the mad scramble for the toilet paper, right? That showed we're not looking out for the interests of others. The mad scramble for sanitary wipes and disinfectant, that shows we're not looking out for the interests of others. It's me. I got to get as much. I got stockpile. Unity, hand in hand with humility. So he goes through this. Right? If you have any inclination at all, if you got any encouragement, any tenderness and compassion, make my joy complete by being unified, locking hands, hand in hand with humility. Humility is the crux of the matter. And I would say the big point of the whole gospel story. In verse 5, we're going to talk about next week. He says, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. And then he gets into this poem about what Christ has done. Next week, we're really going to dive into that. The ultimate example of humility, the ultimate example of giving his life away is Jesus, who looked at you, who considered you, who saw you in the place, looked not just in his interests, but his interests of you, you being lost. Like, you needed salvation. You needed encouragement. You needed tenderness and compassion. You needed comfort. God came, Jesus came to provide for you what you could not have done. And so now us as Christians, We are called to that same level. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, being in whatever high spot he was, right? If anybody could be conceited, if anybody could think, I'm the king of the universe, it was Jesus. And he looked at us and said, you're worth being inconvenienced. You are worth my sacrifice. You are worth me being humilified, right? I'm going to make myself humble, becoming obedient to death on a cross. You, for whatever reason, Jesus calculated and said, you are worth it. And I think he wanted to be unified with us, hand in hand. And the way he did that was humility. Church people, Christians, you are called to be like this. And I'm going to say, like Paul, if you did this, my joy would be complete. My joy would be complete knowing that we continue to live our lives like this. So wherever you are right now, right, make my joy complete. You play soccer because it makes me happy. You are Christians because it makes me happy. And why do you make me happy? It's that unification, right? It's that coming together. Church, you make me happy. You make Christ happy by coming, being unified hand in hand in humility. Let me pray for you. God, thank you for seeing where we were and in your son and his attitude, realizing that we needed saving, that there was an idea that you wanted to be reunified with us, that we broke our relationship with you through sin, that we needed saving, and your son was willing to do that, so we thank you for that. Help us to have that same mind, that same thought, that same purpose. And God, as a church, as we're out and about, help us to continue living this out, building up others around us to equip them, to help them to know Christ and the beauty that is there. God, thank you for bringing us into your family. We pray this in your son's name. Amen. Brian Tolliver, one of our elders, is going to lead us now in a time of communion and offering.
For communion this morning, I'd like to read a couple verses, and then we'll pray for our communion. From John 16:33, "These things I have spoken to you, so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage, I have overcome the world." And then from Romans 5:1, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." Let's go ahead and pray for our communion. Dear Lord, thank you for this opportunity to read your scripture and to remember everything that you've done for us, that you gave it all so that we can find peace in you, and help us to try to stay close to you during this, especially during this time. And it's in your name. Amen. To read a couple of scriptures for offering, and then we'll go from there. Colossians 3:15, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful." And Philippians 4:6, "Be anxious about nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." Let's pray for our offering. Lord God, during this time, I just want to before you just want to be thankful, and I want to challenge us to do more, give more, be more for your kingdom. because of what you have done for us. And it's in your name. Amen. Because of everything that Christ has done for us, I just hope during this trying time that people would be willing to do more. He did everything for us. He gave everything. And hopefully this time helps us to have less roots here on this earth. And hopefully we can think more about the heavenly things. And so I just challenge everyone in the congregation to do more, be more, all in for him.